Hi friends, it's me, Simply Sherry, and this video is the beginning of Vlogmas. I wanted to give you a life update and a channel update. So as you can see from the title that I lost my dad back in July to cancer. So I'm gonna try to get through this video, kind of let you know what's happened and just kind of how it affected my channel. And of course, for sure, my life first, then how it affected my channel. So. So my dad had cancer, prostate cancer, about 20 years ago, and it went away. It went away pretty quickly. And so back in March, I had visited him and my mom because my cousin was visiting here from California. My nephew was visiting here from California. He stayed with me for a couple days. So I brought him there because he was going to stay with them for a couple days. And the whole reason he came here is because my mom has memory care issues. So he wanted to visit her before her memory worsens. So I was over there and I noticed from the beginning that my dad was pretty quiet and he looked a little pale and he was just sitting there on the chair. And usually he engages enough where, you know, and he eats, so he wasn't eating with us. And so I asked him, "Are you okay?" And he said, "Yeah, he's okay." But in my gut, I just felt like, oh, maybe he's just sick. He's not feeling well today. So I just left it at that. And I just checked up on him a couple days later and he said he was feeling fine. Then about a month later in April, I get a call from my brother that my dad had driven himself to the emergency room with my mom and he got checked in to the hospital. And I was like, why? What's wrong? So we went to visit him and he was there for about 5 days. And I was like, okay, this is not good for my dad to seemingly be healthy. And now he's in the hospital for 5 days. Well, then the doctor told us that he had cancer. The prostate cancer had come back and that it was at stage 4. I'm gonna get through this video. I've been wanting to film this video for about 2 weeks and it's just been hard. And of course you would know why. Right, if you've experienced loss, you know how hard it is. But I want to explain it because these events that have happened this year, it really made me think of life, my life, what I wanted to do with it going forward, and just things that are obviously important. And as I mentioned earlier, my mom has memory care issues. And so I think what happened was that my dad, he didn't want to tell any of us because he knew he was the main caregiver for my mom. And I remember even last year asking him around the holidays, I said, "Dad, let me take mom for a week. You know, it'll be fun for her. We can walk, we can go shopping, we can do all these things." So I explained what I would do with her during the week. And he said, "No, it's okay. You know, everything is good." And so I think what happened was, looking back, what had happened was he had gone for his annual checkup sometime end of last year, 2022. And that's when, what is that test to test the prostate? The levels were high. And so he went to the oncologist in January, and that's when he was told that. So just imagine from January, end of January to mid-April, he didn't tell us, and he was taking care of my mom. Because, you know, she can't turn on the stove and things like that anymore. So he was, you know, cooking and doing the errands and just being there for her. And so anyway, I know even my cousin who lives about 10 minutes from them or where they used to live, she mentioned to me, yeah, that they had gone to a mutual friend's, house for dinner. And she noticed, and she's actually a nurse. She noticed that he was kind of pale and kind of the same thing I was seeing in March, but she was seeing this in January. And so now it all made sense, right? It made sense to me why he didn't tell me or my two brothers, and definitely not my mom, because, you know, I don't know how she would have processed it at that time. Okay, so starting from April through, you know, July when he passed, it was in and out of the hospital. And because I work from home, my job is remote, I was the one able to take care of, you know, bringing him to the doctor, bringing him to his immunotherapy, I believe that's what it was called, and then to the hospital, right? There's a week that my brother had done that. He also lives in the Phoenix area. My other brother lives out of state. So we were, working together. And it's been great that my siblings and I, we've just been on the same page the whole time. Very communicative and so grateful for that. Back in May, my son graduated. So we had to graduate from his master's program. So we went to Philly for a week to do all that celebratory things. And that's when my brother was taking care of him. And he was, he had to take his time off. So he has, so when I got back, so we just kind of coordinated when he'd be out, my brother, when he'd be out, and then I'd be here. And then beginning of June, my work has an annual trip. And this year we had gone to Seoul, South Korea. And I haven't even shown any of those videos because it's just been, you know, just kind of hard time. So I remember arriving in Seoul. It was a 14 and a half hour flight. It took about an hour to get out of the airport. And we're in our taxi, you know, it takes an hour from the airport to get into Seoul. So we're in the taxi and my dad calls me and I'm looking at the time. And so I know it's 2 a.m. there back in Phoenix because I'm in Seoul. And he says, he asked me to take him to the hospital. And of course I tell him, I'm in Seoul, Dad, for my meeting. Let me call my brother and have him bring you, or I can call 911. So I called my brother and my brother got there as quickly as he could. It's about a half hour drive. So he's in the hospital for another week while I'm in Seoul. Then I pray to God, please don't let him go. Please don't take him till I get back so I can say bye. So luckily, I was able to get home and take care of him for the last month, I suppose, of his life. I got home. The day I was arriving home, my brother was leaving for also out of the country for a trip that was planned with his family, his wife's family. And it was a 3-week trip. And so, you know, at this point, we're not really sure what the prognosis is. But he was in and out of the hospital. It was only me. And remember, my mom is having memory care issues too. So she's trying to process this and understand what's going on. And I remember doing a lot of Google, asking a couple friends who are doctors how to handle her memory care and explaining and what I'd need to do for my dad. And I remember on my birthday, the week and a half before he passed, I'd taken him to go do his immunotherapy. And when I got to the house, I mean, I just thought, okay, this is coming to an end. This is just getting worse and worse. It took me a half hour to get him from the door to the house, but in the garage, to the car. You know, it's just like right there. And I basically almost had to kind of move him. And at that point, he was about 120 pounds, and he's about 5'9". And so I was with him, he couldn't eat. He was always thirsty. So I bring him to the hospital and he's there for a few hours and then they release him because he looked better. Anyway, so I bring him home and it's just like, as soon as he got home, he just got worse again. And I was just like, I don't know if I should bring him back. So I monitored him for a couple days, asking advice from my doctor friend. But I had to get back. So I went home and then my daughter exchanged and was with him on that Friday night. So just my birthday was a Tuesday. His my daughter's there on a Friday night, and I said, I'll be back on Saturday because after I see these places where to possibly put my dad in a care home to do, you know, 24-hour care. So that Saturday morning, my daughter texts me, I've brought mom and dad to the hospital and they're admitting him. So I was like, okay, let me finish these tours and then I'll get there as soon as I can. And then that was just, that was it. You know, we never basically got him out. Saturday, his oncologist, I mean, I was just praying and praying to be able to meet with the oncologist and him to talk to me and have him talk to my dad. So, I mean, it's just answered prayers. I ran into the oncologist because, you know, they're not there the whole time. You have to catch them. And he just told me, like, this is the worst he's seen and he's not going to do any cancer treatment. And the what they've been doing is not working, the pill, the immunotherapy. And so I asked them, can you talk to my dad? Because I think it'll be easier for him to hear it from you, the doctor that he trusts, versus one of us, one of his family members. And so that following Sunday, the doctor calls. We had stepped out for a couple hours to bring my mom out for dinner, you know, just kind of get her out of the hospital. And that's the time when the doctor went. So at first I thought, I wish I was there when the doctor was there, but then looking back, you know, it was just right that it was him and my dad and him talking to my dad, because by the time we came back, I asked him if the doctor had come by. And at first he said no, but then he said yes. Maybe he had to think about it a little bit. And so we spent like probably 20 minutes. My dad was very lucid. He kind of asked us the things to take care of. Obviously take care of my mom. So we went through all that, which was also, I guess, an answered prayer, because I was very clear and my husband was there, my daughter and my mom. So I had, you know, my daughter and my husband as witnesses to what he said. And of course we were typing it in to my notes just so I wouldn't miss anything. And I remember him looking straight at me and saying, thank you. So the day before, the nurse in charge had asked me, do we do DNR? And I said, no, you resuscitate him. My brother is out of the country. My brother's out of state. They're coming on Monday, Wednesday, and that next Monday. And I remember just them looking at me and I just like, okay, there must be something going on. But they were just like, okay. And then that Monday, the hospital doctor in charge asked me again if we want to do DNR. And I said, no, resuscitate him because my brother's come, same thing. And then she explained to me the prognosis. And honestly, this is the first time like I got a full picture. And basically his whole body was riddled with cancer because it was no longer just in the prostate area. And that if they resuscitate or pushed him, did any chest compressions, then it would just crush him because he's very brittle. And so I said, let me confer with my brothers. And, you know, it was just a lot to communicate. We were texting back and forth. My brother is in a whole different time zone in Asia. He's on his way back. And I basically said, listen, you guys need to come here now, because I felt it. You can feel it. And I said, but because that was a Monday, right? My brother's going to come the following Monday. My other brother's coming that Wednesday. And I said, you need to come now. You need to get on the earliest flight, and the one coming from out of state. And then the other one, I said, just try to get here sooner. And the hospice came in and I said, yes to hospice. I understand hospice. And so by Wednesday, they were trying to get him out by Thursday because my brother was arriving from out of the country Wednesday, but we were able to get him out Wednesday because they were really pushing it and I felt it. I'm like, they just know it's his time. So we got him out Wednesday and I told my brother, he's in LA and it's literally a 12-hour layover. And I said, you have to get here. Tell the people at the front desk of, you know, the airline and say, here's my situation. Can you get me on an earlier flight? And he did that. And that's what they did. He got on an earlier flight. And so as the hospice was bringing him to their house, I'm coming from the hospital with my mom. My brother's coming from the airport from Asia, from LA. And as he's arriving, my brother's arriving, and then we arrive 10 minutes later. And I tell you, that was around 5 p.m. By 10, my dad was still a little bit lucid. By 10 p.m., he was not, it was just different, you know? I mean, he was not fully there. And so I just, and then my other brother from out of state arrived Thursday. And so it was just, you know, I guess I thank all the doctors, the nurses who were very professional, knew what they're doing, the hospice, of guiding me each step and telling me this is the stage he's going through. And I was able to make those decisions and make those decisions with my brothers. And so my brother had said, had felt the same thing. Well, we wanted him to not be DNR because he wanted to get back in and say bye to him. And I just think it worked out. It worked out that he arrived there at the house in that those hours where he was still fully lucid. So I stayed overnight, and my dad just got worse. And my brother arrived from out of state. So he took over Thursday, and I was home Thursday and Friday, two full days. And I tell you, I just, you know, the week before, remember I brought him back from the hospital. It's a Tuesday, it was my birthday. That Wednesday night, I get back and he's literally on the floor. I had hired a caregiver, and the caregiver left him on the floor. That's a whole, I don't want to get into that, but I called my doctor friend and I said, my dad is on the floor. And he tells me to use my Apple Watch to test his heart rate and all this stuff. And that was the time I said, you know what, this is not good. And so all this, you know, I guess stress, it caught up with me. So that Thursday and Friday, I was literally in bed for those 2 days straight. And I'm laying in bed with all this chaos happening, all the emotional decisions that my brothers and I had to make, all the communicating with the doctor and the nurse and my family and the texting and my relatives, my own family, you know, and my brother's families. I think it just caught up with me. And I just was laying in bed. But you know, the thing that I thought of all this chaos, I sat here and I thought, you know, if one thing that's in control is that, which I don't know if this sounds weird, but that my house is in order, that my home, I could come to my bedroom, which is here, and say that this is my sanctuary. And I can recharge here, you know, that my home is a place that is not just organized, but I guess the benefits or the ripple effect of being organized is that I can come home and feel some peace and tranquility. That it's a place that I can, I guess, be refreshed or recharged enough that I can take on the chaos that was happening in my life at that point. So I go back Saturday, and my dad passes that evening around 8 p.m. And even that, we had a 24-hour caregiver, even though we were all there, you know, there's always someone watching, one of, you know, me or my brothers. We still had a caregiver 24 hours. And even that, just having that caregiver explaining, hospice explaining, okay, this is what's happening. He's transitioning. And just having that knowledge, I think, was very helpful. Yeah, so anyway, I love my dad. I miss him. And so now we're working on obviously caring for my mom. She now lives near me. And So that's, you know, still an ongoing process. But at this point, you know, it's as best as we can make it, and very grateful to the people who help her now. Grateful that she's near me, and grateful that my brothers and I are on the same page. And also, you know, just the care that my mom needs now, I'm just grateful for. It also made me think about, you know, the legacy that my dad left, that the life they built, and that, you know, it just makes you think about your purpose in life. So with all that explaining, I guess hopefully it helps you just to know that, you know, you're not alone. And I'm sorry if you've experienced loss. It is hard, you know, but you have to move on. And one thing that I think really impacted me was just thinking, you know, what legacy do I want to leave behind? But also just you know, those 2 days I was laying in bed, and I wasn't sure. I wasn't sure when I was going to get out of bed. But it was just like an epiphany for me that, you know, when I organize, there's really a reason for it. It's not just to put a YouTube video or to be able to take a picture and post it on Facebook or Instagram and say, you know, look how nicely organized this is. But it really helped me in that moment, in those moments where life was chaotic and I had no control. But that was the one thing that gave me peace, was knowing that, just, you know, the feeling that my home gave me, and I just felt safe in that, in those moments. So it made me think about, you know, what do I want to do going forward? 'Cause time is short, you know, and do I want to continue this YouTube thing, this YouTube channel? And I realized, you know what, I really do, because now I feel called. I feel called to really give the knowledge that I have and that I've learned, and the skills that I've honed through the years. Like I said earlier, just the knowledge that the medical professionals were giving me, it really helped me. And I was able to take that knowledge and make decisions based on it, which I think made the path a little bit less rocky. So now with my channel, you know, I do want to, I'm working actually on, I'm sorry. First of all, I'm doing this Vlogmas, which is 25 days of videos straight. And it's more of just kind of casual, you know, hey, these are projects I'm doing. Hey, this is one, you know, look at, I do like to entertain. So here's some videos of how I did this little party, or I'm showing you updates of my prepper pantry or things like that. Just kind of more, you know, showing you stuff that I've worked on, maybe in ways that it could help you. And then when I'm not doing the vlogging, starting in January, I'm just going to do more focused videos on how to organize and really help you organize your life for, you know, not just big events like this where you really need peace and a sanctuary, but the day-to-day, you know, that it helps you move towards decisions in your life that is going to be the life that you want to live, right? Yes, and then also I'm working on a course, finally. I've been told to do a course for several years. I finally had, I guess it just clicked. It just clicked, like, yes, this is, I do want to make a course. I do want to teach people more, you know, instead of casually, how to organize. And so I'm working on a course right now. It should hopefully launch, if not by end of January, maybe sometime in February. Yeah, but I guess what's most important, I guess, to convey to you as far as my channel update is that, yeah, I'm gonna still be on YouTube. I might do VEDA, which is video every day in April, VLOGmas, which is vlogging in August, VLOGtober, and then Vlogmas again. So those 4 months, I'm just doing the vlogging style, And then the other months is more targeted, specific videos about organizing. Because I think that will help me with my own creative flow, my own schedule, and just feeling like, you know, there's other things I want to talk about. And we'll just see how that goes. You know, please comment in the future videos what you think. I love your feedback. I've always appreciated feedback, you know, what, how you think, how it prompted you to do this, any questions you have. Yeah, you just want to make this, keep this community interactive and help you get organized. Yeah, so that's my update. Thanks for, you know, this was a hard video to make. I don't necessarily want to be crying on the internet, let alone YouTube. But I don't know how I, you know, every time I thought of making this video, I would start crying. So I just don't know how I would even, I don't think I could ever do this video without crying. So anyway, now I'm crying on the internet and on YouTube. So it is what it is. But anyway, thanks for being here. Thanks for listening. I appreciate your lending your ear, lending your shoulder, giving your heart, and supporting me all these years. So keep your loved ones close, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye.